Hi, my name is Kai Magnusson Parma, and I'm the captain in Ocean X team.
My name is Peter Lindberg, and I'm the co-owner of Ocean X team.
Hi, my name is Åsberg. I'm the co-owner of Ocean X team.
Hello, my name is Stefan Hogeborn, and I'm the diver of Ocean X team.
Hello, I'm Jong. I've been working on a COE.
My name is Grant Pearson. I'm a geologist in Australia. And,
Hello, my name is Stan Constantin. I'm 37 years old. I'm from Romania.
Hi, I'm Billy Carson. I'm co-founder of UFA, United Family of Anomaly Hunters. Also the founder of Forbidden Knowledge on Facebook and Instagram.
Hi, my name is Jarmo Kortanimi. I'm a by training I'm a planetary geomorphologist.
I want to take you on a journey. A journey to find some more answers to what the Baltic Sea Anomaly could be. A journey into people's minds, thoughts and ideas regarding the anomaly. A journey starting with the Ocean X team, Peter Lindberg, Stefan Hogeborn, Kai Magnusson and Dennis Åsberg. A journey together with geologists, ancient history researchers and UFO believers. My name is Thomas Mikey. I'm your host, and this is my first ever documentary.
My name is Peter Lindberg, and I'm the co-owner of Ocean X team.
Meanwhile, there's been a fresh UFO sighting near the Russian border at the bottom of the Baltic Sea. Sea surveyors say they found what can only be described as the wreckage of a crashed spaceship. Our correspondent Daria Pushkova knows the truth is out there, and let's see what she can tell us, because she's with me in the studio. Thank you so much for coming over. Tell us, please, what is all the fuss about?
Peter Lindberg has been in the business for almost 20 years. This vintage champagne hauled from a century-old wreck, one of his sweetest successes. Until, that is, the commercial diver stumbled upon an incredible find.
We had been out for 9 days, and well, we were quite tired, and we were on our way home, but we made a final run with the sonar fish, and suddenly this thing turned up.
Hello, Peter. Thank you for joining us here today. I'm honored to have you here.
Thank you.
You know that I have been talking to a lot of people about their thoughts about the anomaly. What do people believe the anomaly is? And I have had theories about volcanoes. We had simple rocks, natural formations. We have, you know, the ancient construction theories. We had the out of this world theories. There have been a lot of guesses from different people to what the anomaly could be. So now it would be very interesting to hear what does you, Peter Lindberg, that was on the spot back then in 2011, think today in May 2016 that the anomaly could be?
My thoughts about the anomaly has been all the time that it is most probably something natural. And even if it's a bit odd in its shape, even if it's natural, it might be that some ancient people has been there. We don't know. And the discussion today is more like, It's either a big ferromanganese concretion or something made of magma. It's a volcanic eruption, or it is something else, or it's something else. what I have seen, it has a bit of each thing. We see the concretions, yes, no doubts about that. But we also have these features which looks very much like a magma flow. And it will be more clear when we will publish those videos about it.
That would be my next question. How about those videos? Are there something coming up, or are the footages lost forever?
There will be. It will be videos, new videos presented, and it's not new. It's old, but they are restored.
They are new to the public. They haven't been published before.
The videos hasn't been published before, and they are, have been restored from a broken hard disk. It's not from the hard disk we have been talking about before. That's on that one. It's other kind of stored data.
Okay.
These are just the ROV, some of the ROV videos, and. I think you could clearly see that it looks very much like magma flow. And as I said, it will be more clear when you see the whole sequence instead of the still image that we have presented.
Of course.
So I see that it looks like magma flow. We have these stones laying around there with the concretion on it, which was said that it must be some burnt biological material from the beginning. I don't think so. I think it is this ferromanganese concretion. And the lab results were, it was a misinterpret. They didn't know so much about ferromanganese concretions. That might have been a misunderstanding.
But then I have one more question here, because we all remember one of the pictures that went worldwide and viral was a picture of the square frame with the 2 meter round hole from one of the Blue View images. How about that? Could that be a trigger flight? We know that the Blue View sonar operates with sound waves, sending out a sound wave, receiving it back again, and creates a picture in colors from those sound waves. Could that be a trigger of light, that square frame with the round hole in?
I think that the square frame with a which looks like a hole inside is a kind of a false visual image, since we haven't found that. I mean, if it would been a 2 meter hole on top of the anomaly, I think we would have found it. And I think that's the shadows are playing us a trick. That is what I think.
Then we have the 90 degree angle in the corridor. Do you have any explanation for that? I know you're not a geologist, but do you have any ideas of how that could have occurred?
Well, 90 degrees angles are not so strange in these areas, probably it's made of the ice that has scratched the rock itself and then carried away the loose rocks. But I don't know. I'm not sure.
No, okay. I remember we had some new pictures from A2, was it in 2000 and late 2014, where the latest Blue View images and sonars came up showing a 27 meters long object, 7 meters wide. Is that something you see often when you're looking at sonar images and Blue View scans?
Well, about the anomaly number two, we passed that 2014 with a different kind of side scanner and got a much more clearer image than the first one from 2011. And well, it actually looks like a big rock slab or rock laying there, which is approximately 30 meters long, 27 or 30, and 6-7 meters wide. And well, no, we don't see that especially often. I know at one place we have seen something similar, and I think I have posted an image of that on in the Facebook group. And it's of similar size as well. Mm. But it is like 40 nautical miles from this area. Often when it's loose rocks like this, I think what I learned, I might be wrong, that it should be laying in one direction, following the ice or whatever. Well, and this one doesn't really follow the pattern of what is created by the ice. I don't, probably something just quite ordinary, but I would certainly would like to have a look at the anomaly number two as well.
Yes, and the $100,000 question that everybody is waiting for. Will Ocean X come back to the Baltic Sea Anomaly and make new dives? Is there any plans of going back now? Is there a date for anything?
At the moment, we have nothing planned for going back to the anomalies. And the plans we have made is we've been looking around for possibilities to make a core drill, core sample, which we have found. But despite of that, no, there is no physical plans.
No. Peter Lindberg, thank you very much for contributing to this.
Thank
video.
You. Yes. Yeah. You're welcome.
I hope we will hear some more news from you and your amazing team that we all can follow on the Ocean Explorer on Facebook here. Thank you.
Thank you.
En förringare det var och hennes namn var Typhoon som seglar från oss in till den hon
och jävla skit. Hi, my name is Kai Magnusson Parma and I'm the captain in Ocean X team.
And here's Kai.
Hi.
What's happened now? What are we gonna do?
I'm Facebooking.
On Facebook? Yeah. Tell me.
Hi, my name is Kai Magnusson Parma, and I'm the captain in Ocean X team. And about the anomaly, my personal opinion is that it's actually some result from an old volcanic eruption made on the last age of ice age. And why I think so, it's when the sample we took, it was a lot of mangan in it, and the shape of this big rock, I think it's the magma was coming up, and then it was about 2.5, maybe 3 kilometers of ice, so it was a very high pressure, and then it was cooling down very quickly. And then they have had this strange shape. And it's also a little interesting because the authority, especially in Sweden here, they don't like us, of course, because we are coming with this, if there is something with volcanic eruption, it could put everything on the edge, because all the marine geologic guys have for years talked about this. There's nothing It's never been an eruption, a volcanic eruption for the last 700. And if we can prove that this was actually for 15,000 years ago, it could be very sensitive because we have built a lot of new clear power plants around Baltic Sea. So they don't like our theory about this. So, well, that's my personal opinion about it. But I must also say, when we were out there, as you know, it was a lot of strange things happening around the boat and in the deep. The divers broke their equipment, and we have strange signals. And you know, we didn't have any contact with our satellite phone when we were exactly above the object. But when we moved the boat 200 meters, we had contact with the satellite phone, and so on, so on. So it's it's more question than answers.
Hello, my name is Stefan Hogeborn, and I'm the diver of Ocean X team.
Hello and welcome, Stefan. Thank you for contributing with your thoughts here. I am very honored to have you here.
Yeah.
And
thank you. Thank you for letting me be here.
As many of you out there know, Stefan was the diver that was the first person that actually dived down to the anomaly. It was also Stefan who took this test sample that was sent to the Weizmann Institute in Israel. Stefan, I would like to ask, what were you thinking when you dived down to the anomaly the first time after you had seen the sonar scan?
Oh, that was pretty amazing because nobody really knew what it was. It could be anything. It sure looked strange on the sonar pictures. So there was a lot of thoughts running through my head. Was this the scoop, the fantastic pictures of the lifetime, or was it just a rock? Mm. So there was a lot of things running through my head, and if I had a pulse meter, it would probably have peaked the pulse of my heart.
Were you afraid when you were down there?
Not really, because you're at those depths, which is about 2.5 times deeper than normal scuba diving. You're so focused, so you're not really afraid. You're just focused and tensed, and your senses are very, very, very tensed. Mm. So I was tensed.
You was tensed.
Yeah.
I remember a video made on a cruise ship with the Ocean X and some friends of the team, where you said in a very specific way that this cannot be just a rock. Will you say the same thing today, 5 years later?
Yeah, it's not just a rock. It's still a big question mark for us. So if it would have been a rock, that would have been very easy to tell. Mm. It's not. It's not a rock that I've seen anywhere else. So it's still a puzzle.
Okay, then we come to the big question, because we already heard Peter Lindberg said here just before you came up what he's thought the anomaly is, and he is still talking in the direction of natural formation. Now, what do you, Stefan Hogeborn, that was at the anomaly and dived down there and actually touched it, what do you think the anomaly could be?
I usually don't talk about what I think. I usually don't think. I usually know or don't know. In this particular case, I don't know. But if you're asking me what a guess, a probable guess could be, if you ask me for my point,
yes,
my personal point, or my personal guess, it is probably something that came out of the earth itself, from the inside, through a volcano, through a crack in the surface of the earth. But I don't know how it ended up there.
No.
That's still the big question.
But then again, if all the marine geologists and biologists have said there hadn't been any volcano in the past many, many, many hundreds and thousands of years, could it then be that Ocean X maybe are gonna prove them wrong in some way?
Actually, I don't know. I just know that it's not a normal rock. I'm pretty sure it's not a UFO, because I haven't seen any proof of it being a UFO. I haven't seen any proof of it being a normal rock. But since it has been very, very hot somewhere in its contact with water or the earth, I mean that's sort of some proof of it being a volcano form.
Mm.
or a lava formation or I mean something.
Mm.
How it came there, I don't know. There are several theories. One theory could be that it's been put on the ice during the ice age, and during the transportation of the ice, and when it melted, it could have just fallen off underneath the ice when it was melting. You know, there was ice, mm, water, and then the bed of the Baltic Sea.
Mm.
That could have been one way, because it's lying on top or laying on top of clay that's the smallest part of rock being crushed by the ice from the ice age. Mm. Since it's on top of the clay, it must have ended there after or during the ice moving.
But how about what people describe as the drag mark or the ridge? What's your thought on the ridge? Some people say it doesn't even exist, and some people say the ridge does exist, and some people say it points in another direction. What's your guesses about the ridge or the drag mark, as it's been called popular?
It could have been it could have been from the ice moving, because when the ice moves, it could have been shallower, the ice, the thickness of the ice, so it didn't touch it when it fell off the ice. I mean, think of it, we have a volcano shooting out lava or whatever that ends up in the ice, and more ice gets on top of the ice, and then when it melts, it's melting from underneath, and then at some point it gets away from the ice and end up on the bottom. And then you can have another thickness of the ice moving over it and then drag it at a later point. And that's just my guess. But that could have been a possible scenario.
Scenario, yes. How many times did you actually dive down to the anomaly?
I don't know, but it's more than five, but not more than 10. But somewhere in the neighborhood of 5 to 10. There was a couple of dives that we didn't reach the bottom. We had to start all over again because of malfunctioning of equipment. But then when we did the filming and the samples from the anomaly, that would have been around about 5 or 6 dives.
I asked Peter Lindberg about the square frame with the circular hole in that was estimated to be 2 meters, and I asked him if he believed if this was a trigger flight, so to speak. What do you think of the square frame with the 2 meter hole in, and do you think it's a kind of trigger flight, or are we looking at an actually square frame with a 2 meter wide hole in?
I have no clue. I haven't investigated that part of the anomaly enough to be able to tell you any thoughts of it. It could have just been shadows. It could have been, just light or shadows playing tricks with us. I don't know, because I haven't been inside the hole. I haven't put my hands into the hole.
You have not.
We were actually searching because we were planning on playing some tricks with Peter and the other crews. So we were planning to put a small gas tank, open it up and put it in the hole and film it, just to play some tricks with them, and just go to the surfer and say, "Hey, take a look at this!" Oh. But we couldn't find the hole.
You couldn't find
the hole. So we couldn't. We could never do the trick on them. of course, a more serious part of the search for the hole was, of course, to investigate the hole itself.
See if you can lower down a camera or something like that.
Exactly.
Yeah.
With lights and stuff. So, I mean,
what's your thoughts about all the interference you had, electrical interference, and the problems you had when you were about the anomaly? We know there was the satellite connection didn't work when you were about. We know you had some problems with the lights and some of the engines and the ROV. What's your thoughts on that? Is that something you experience? You see often when you are doing the expedition with the Ocean X team.
When they happened one after each other in a couple of hours time, it was very, very strange for us. But when we're looking back at it, we had problems almost every time we tried to use the phone. The satellite phone, because we had to put the phone in a certain direction, and when the boat moved, we couldn't really understand that we wasn't pointing in the right direction because we didn't understand that the boat were moving. So that could have been it.
But
the camera that didn't work, it was telling me to put in the cleaning cassette on our way down. And afterwards, we understood while looking through the data that was on my dive computer that the temperature were about 2 degrees minus Celsius. And that could have been something that put steam or whatever you call it on the head of the cassette.
Yeah.
Recorder on the camera. So when we switched to digital cameras, we never had that problem. Okay. So with all the problems stacking up when we were there the first time, it was very, very strange. But when we went through all the problems and solved it, they really never happened again. No. So
I would like to.
And what really made the work finally filming it was a cheap GoPro camera that we weren't supposed to be able to take to those depths because it was only rated to 40 meters. And for you who have seen the video, you hear a beep in the background, and that's the buttons that was pushed in because of the pressure.
Exactly.
Yeah. So one of the cameras, because I have a rack with three GoPros, because I was really, really prepared to get some pictures up. Mm. And one of the cameras was stuck. So it was turning off, turning on, turning off, turning on.
I remember the beep constantly from the video.
But two of the other cameras were actually filming. So the cool thing is that it's actually filmed in 3D, because I have two cameras filming it. And two on two different cameras at the same time. So,
okay, is there something you're actually gonna produce in 3D in some time?
Yeah.
Yeah, that would be great. That would be great. Is there any chance that you will go back there again with the team or with some other team, or do you only work with OceanX team?
For me, it's not important who goes there. For me, it's important to get an answer to all the questions we have. So if anybody comes up with the funds that's needed to do dives on it, because I'm just a diver, I'm no scientist. I'm just the person who are able to go down and with my hands do whatever somebody tells me to do. So if you tell me to film it, I can film it. If you tell me to take samples, I can take samples. If you want me to drill a hole in it, I will drill a hole in it. But it needs to be from a scientific source. And if it's really important, maybe we can find somebody to fund it for us.
Exactly.
But for now, I don't have the funds in my pocket to do it. And since I don't know what to do, it's just a waste of money and time to go there. I don't know. I mean, you know, you're the one who's speaking to all the scientists. let's find out what they want. And let's find out a way to get what they want. And I'd be happy to help.
So let's reach out to the scientists and those that actually can fund an expedition with those next team out there. If any one of you are interested in participating, contributing to getting any closer to an explanation of what the Baltic Sea Anomaly is, then you can contact the OceanX team or Stefan Hogeborn here. You could probably find them on Facebook. But Stefan, before we are going to end here.
Yeah.
I have had a lot of questions from people around the world about the dive down there. Many people are asking, why don't they just go out there, and why didn't they just stay there a little longer? Why didn't they get better pictures? Why this and why that? And most of the question is about the quality of pictures and the amount of time that you could be able to spend there. Could you explain to people out here why you only could stay down there for around about 15 minutes?
Because of the complexity of the dive. It's deep, it's dark, and it's really cold. And I mean, your body could just do what the body can do. And that is to stay down for, maybe we could stretch it to 20 or 25 minutes. That's could have been doable, but there was no reason for it, because when we plan dives like this, we plan to do one or maximum two objectives on one dive. Because if we have 5 or 10 objectives or tasks to do, We will probably just come up with five of them half done. Mm. So we plan be able to finalize one or two tasks, which could have been filming a certain part, and that took a couple of dives to get the camera that worked, and then to take samples. But that's just what we are able to do. As we, it's so extreme itself to just be able to be there free swimming as divers as we are.
It's not.
I mean, we could with greater funds, we could put an oil drill platform on top of it. But then it would probably cost millions of dollars per 24 hours to do that. And if somebody has the funds, be my guest.
So basically,
for us, as the small funds we have, just work in those small time frames that we have.
So basically,
15 to 25 minutes.
So basically, just to dive 90 meters below surface is not just something you do because you have tried diving one or two times before. It really takes a lot of knowledge to do that. How long time does it take to go up from 90 meters below surface?
From 90 meters with about 15 or 20 minutes on the bottom, it's about 2 hours back to the surface.
Because of the pressure, the decompression?
Yeah, yes. Because of the pressure down there, and you absorb so much gases in your body, and you have to be able to let your body be able to get rid of that gas when we're that expanding gas when we're going up.
But
when the pressure releases, the gas expands. It's like shaking a Coca-Cola. It's going to just explode, and you don't want to be that Coca-Cola that explodes.
because it's
hard on your body. So we have to take it very, very carefully. So if we shake the soda, we have to release the pressure very, very carefully so it doesn't explode.
Okay, yes.
That's why it takes so long.
So an hour and a half to 2 hours to go up from a dive to the surface, from a dive to the anomaly, is normal procedure.
Exactly. So when you're asking for 15 minutes of our focus, that's actually 2 hours and 15 minutes of our total survival focus. So it's hard.
It's hard. How about the visibility down there? Because I know if I remember correct, you once said something like 2 to 3 meters on a good day.
Yes. And on the particular dives we did, it was about 1 or 2 meters of visibility.
And that will also explain why we see on the first video we have from the dive that we cannot actually see much on that video.
No. And that's it doesn't really matter. The visibility doesn't really matter because when we're filming, we have a fisheye lens on. So we're very close. We're about 20 to 30 centimeters close when we're filming. So if it's 1 meter visibility or 10 meters, it doesn't really matter, as long as it's at least 20 to 30 centimeters. Mm. So that doesn't really matter. But for us, when we're searching over a bigger area, when we're not filming, it's kind of hard when we don't see so far. I mean, it's like asking an ant how a football field looks like.
Yes.
He doesn't know. He knows how a grass straw looks like.
Yes, exactly. It's a good way of explaining it.
It's how we look at the anomaly when we're down there. Mm. We're like that ant on the football field.
You're seeing a few centimeters ahead.
Exactly.
Exactly, yes. Stefan, we have a lot of people here that want to contribute with their thoughts on the anomaly after you, Peter Lindberg, and Kai Magnusson also. I want to thank you a million times for joining us here today, and I hope that you and your amazing team will come back with some more news, and I also hope that, that you will get some funds to do the final expedition, if we can call it that, to the anomaly, so we can in a scientific way get proof, the exact proof for what it is that is down there. Stephen, thank you for taking your time here.
Yeah, thank you, Thomas.
Yes. Bye.
Hi, my name is Dennis Åsberg. I'm the co-owner of Ocean XT.
Hello, Dennis, and welcome here. I'm glad that you could join us today so we could hear your thoughts on the anomaly. I'm honored to have you here, Dennis. Welcome.
Thank you. I'm honored to be on your show.
You know that I have been talking to your colleagues at the OceanX team, and they have been telling us about their thoughts on the anomaly, and we have heard a lot of different explanations from other members of the Ocean Explorer group, and I have had some comments from geologists, and I have had some comments from UFO believers, and I have had a lot of comments from people who believe in the ancient civilization theory. So I am looking very much forward to hear what your thoughts on the Baltic Sea anomaly could be here 5 years later after you and your crew found it back then.
Oh, believe me, I'm still thinking about that. What can it be? And of course, I do, like you and other people do, speculate. I really don't know what we have found. Of course, if I'm try to be down to earth. After have talked with lots of people under 5 years with scientists and so on. I mean, we have found basalt, and something have burned down there, some biologic thing, and. And after have speaking with lots of people who are who have the you know understanding about that, yeah, it can be volcano that we have found, but of course that can be very very interesting if we have. But at the same time, it's another part of me that says that. The angles, the shape of the object, and the position of the object, it says to me that perhaps it is something else, a meteorite, perhaps.
But wouldn't a meteorite break up in thousands of miles?
Yeah, you're right.
The atmosphere.
So I can sit here and speculate. I mean, for many hours, what it can be. I really don't know. And the most important thing for me, and as I have mentioned on the internet so many times now, is to go out again and do a real expedition with people who have the understanding and science. That I think is most important thing to do now. But of course, I'm thinking outside the box, as you do and many other people. And from the beginning, when we found this thing, it's 60 meter in diameter and round, and then we have been down and looked at it for many, many hours with our ROV, and we have also dived on the object.
and see these holes and angles and walls, and of course you begin to, oh, perhaps this is something that is constructed, but it's still a but, you know, we don't really know.
No.
So
I would like to ask you, because I saw a video just before I called you here on Skype, where you actually saying, yes, the Swedish Navy is very interested in our project.
Yes, the military is very, very interested in our project.
Are the Navy still interested in that project, and have you had some collaboration with the Swedish Navy about the project?
They are interested in our project, have always been, but still they will not go into the project, because this object or volcano or whatever it is, it's on international water. So that's the reason they cannot go out.
But how comes a Swedish Navy became interested in the Baltic Sea Anomaly when we don't know what it is? We have geologists saying it's simple rocks.
But you are interested, and lots of other people.
I am interested, yes, and I will always be.
We are just people. Even the militaries we talk to are people, and are very interesting to know what we have found. But still, you know, if you're going to put time and money on this from the, you know, government level, the Navy, it's the tax money. And it's on international water. So that's the reason they cannot take the next step into it. But of course, they are interesting to know what we have found. But still, they cannot use their own equipment to go out in the Baltic Sea on international water to do an experiment. You know, it's...
Of course not. Some of the first theory that came up was the out of this world, the UFO theories, and a lot of people said that they could believe they could have been a crashed spaceship UFO from outer space crashing on to Earth a long time ago. And I remember we talked a lot about that. Do you still think there is any chance that it could be so?
I believe in UFOs. I have always, and not always, since 96. And why not? We don't know so much about the oceans, what we have down there. So I think we know more about the moon and what we know about the oceans.
But Dennis, if we look at the shape of the object, that's a shape like the Millennium Falcon. Is there anything else on this object that could lead our mind in the direction of a crashed spaceship or something from out of this world besides the shape? Is there any thing that we can point at and say, this could make me think it could be...
Not really. We have this track on the bottom that looks like something have, in my eyes, crashed. And that's what we have. And then we had lots of electrical problems when we were out and diving, and that we know, that problem we had when we were out. But in details... It's too soon to say. We must do more, you know, exploring there to really get the answer. So it's just speculation for me if I sit and say, oh, that and that can be and that. You know, I don't really know.
No one actually does. I've been speaking to a lot of people about this, and I have... Since you guys created the Facebook group about the Baltic Sea Anomaly, I have more than 250 new friends from Facebook.
That's great.
All had the interest in the Baltic Sea Anomaly in one way or another, and that was regardless if they believed it was a rock or an ancient construction or volcano or out of this world. I made a lot of new friends. How many people had come into your life after you came out.
Oh, there are many. But to my life, if you're talking about Facebook, of course, I'm open and want to talk to people. I'm a very social person. You know, I have received lots of shit also, as you have heard before.
I remember
this. So it's not just positive things. It's lots of shit in this, you know, to be in the spotlight. And it's not always good to be so open as I am. That don't mean that everything I say is right, but I'm open with my thoughts. And, you know, in my, I am out there. I'm working with this. This is my full-time work. We have been out there so many times and have seen what we have, you know, seen that thing. But we still don't know what we have found yet. And, of course, people ask me on Facebook or sending me mails, Dennis, what's the next step? Or what's the problem? Why have you not been there? Just dive down there and take care of the problem. Oh, yeah. It's not so easy. I try to explain like 500 times. So it's not just good or fun to be.
No, not always. No. I had the same questions from people all over the world. Why don't they just dive down there? And I had Stefan explaining the issues being a diver diving down there. And I had Peter talking a little bit about how difficult it is just to get out there and arrange the ships and such stuff like that. How much would it cost in diesel fuel alone to go from, let's say, Nortalia to the area in a ship like M22?
What the question?
How much would it cost?
I mean, it's that, you know, even if you buy or rent the ship for that, what's the purpose for it? Mm. You must think like that. In that case, when we're talking about the anomaly, to dive down to 90 meters, to really do an expedition down there, you see 1 meter, perhaps 30 centimeters in front of you. You don't see so much. I think that we must focus on the next step to have the real equipment, not use the same equipment. We have already been there a couple of times, as you know, and we must come further. And to do that, we really need the right equipment. And also, not only the equipment, the people who understand what we have in front of us. You know, it's one thing to have a discussion with scientists on an office and to see all the pictures. We want them to be with us at the place. And that's the next step, to take the scientists with us and the right equipment to take samples. And what that's going to cost, I really don't know. But it's not like 100 crowns. It costs lots of money.
If I remember correct, I think the cost in diesel fuel alone was something like $20,000 for 5 days, something like that.
Then comes
the cost for the crew and renting ships and equipment and food and so on and so on and so on.
Yep.
So it's not an easy task just to perform, to go out there and dive down and...
But also it's very important for people to know that, I mean, this is our work, that this is what we're doing. We are spending time and money on a company that we're working with other projects like diving on pipes and so on. So and working for the police for helping to find people. We're working with other wrecks that we know there are money. In this case, when we're talking about the object in the Baltic Sea, we don't know. Nobody pay us for that.
No.
So in the end, somebody must pay the bill for the fuel and the insurance and the divers and so on. And that's the problem also when we go in and talk with sponsors. What's in it for us, they say. Mm. We don't know. So it's not easy. No.
You had at one time, I know you had a sponsor that was Volvo. What happened with
but that's no money.
There was
no money.
No money.
No
they,
money.
They were only sponsoring cars.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because we need cars.
Yes, to come around. Okay. Do you have any other? Have you had any other sponsors for some of your other operations at sea?
Yeah, that's more interesting for sponsors to get involved in. When we're talking about the sub or we're talking about other wrecks, whatever, we have champagne and cognac and so on, it's much easier. You can, you know, you have it down there. They know what it is. And if it is a success in that case, I mean, they get published in marketing, product,
but whatever. But the question was, did you have other sponsors for some of your other operations when you're diving for wrecks? Have you had other sponsors so far?
No. I don't know. If you're talking about other wrecks projection, we're talking about ROV, we're talking about the cars, we're talking about boats we have used, but no money. We can use the product, the tools, but it's still no money.
No. Okay. Dennis, I would like to ask you, and I've asked Peter and I have asked Stefan the same question. What does the future look like for OceanX team now? What are your plans for the future?
Oh. Next question. I hope it looks bright. That's what we are working for. It's, you know, to what we are doing, it's not so many people who is so crazy as we and searching for wrecks. But we're still doing it because we believe in it. We are like small kids still trying to find the treasure. And of course, they cost time and money, but still we believe in what we are doing. And we believe also we're going to find something that can make this company still going
exist,
up,
yes.
You know, yeah, yes. Exist.
Yes.
So that's our hope. But, you know, you never know.
No, you never know. Dennis, I have one more question for you about the ROV hard disk that broke down, because we saw some of the footages, still frames, published on Facebook. And is there any time frame or idea of when we are going to see the last of those pictures?
No,
or maybe videos?
It's lots of pictures, it is. And the sad thing is very, very bad quality in them. And of course, we're going to put time on that and see if we can do anything. Because I have seen also when we put up them on the internet, on Facebook, we have a couple of guys who take care of to manage to make them better in shape and so on. So why not? Of course, we're going to sit down. And there are lots of films that we must
video look. Recordings.
It's video it's not pictures, it's video recording. But like 90% of this is nothing, is nada. But we're using most time the blue view, the sonar. Mm.
Is there any more upcoming moving blue view sonar scans? We saw the moving blue view with the 90 degree angles.
No, it's not. And I think I must focus my time on the next step instead for digging in old things. You know, the only thing we must do now is to go out again. When we're talking about the object, go out again with ROV, a good sonar, and of course scientists with us, and do it one more time.
So we can get the final answer to what it could be that is.
Perhaps
down
you can
there.
Get final answer, but perhaps we can get the answer from a scientist on the spot. Not from Peter, May and Kai and Stefan. from a guy who knows about things. If it is a natural thing, I mean, perhaps it is a volcano that we have found. And wow, if we have found. Perhaps it's a meteorite. But perhaps it is also something that is constructed there before the Ice Age. That we don't know yet. So, you know, the best thing is to go out again. When we're going to do it? I don't know. Soon, I hope.
So do we. Dennis, thank you for taking part and contributing with your thoughts.
Thank you very much for having me on the show.
Yes. Good luck. Thank you.
Good luck.
Bye.
Hi, I'm Billy Carson. I'm co-founder of UFA, United Family of Anomaly Hunters. Also the founder of Forbidden Knowledge on Facebook and Instagram.
My name is Grant Pearson. I'm a geologist in Australia and currently in Sydney, Australia.
Hello, my name is John Johnstone and I live in Philadelphia. And I also work as a physicist.
Hi, my name is Jarmo Kortanimi. I'm by training, I'm a planetary geomorphologist.
Hi, I'm Angela Davis, and here to talk about the Baltic Sea Anomaly.
Hello, I'm Jong. I've been working on a COE that might be able to explain what the anomaly is.
Hello, my name is Stan Constantin.
My name's Ollie. I'm from England.
Hi, my name is Laura Funke.
The angles, the shape of the object, and the position of the object, it says to me that perhaps it is something else.
Hi, I'm Billy Carson. I'm co-founder of UFA, United Family of Anomaly Hunters, also the founder of Forbidden Knowledge on Facebook and Instagram. I've been evaluating and studying the Baltic Sea Anomaly since 2011, when it was first discovered. I was absolutely astonished by it and began doing my own research and following up on the OceanX team as much as I possibly could from the United States. I remember when it went international on the news, and CNN picked it up. Now, for CNN to pick something up like this, such a very taboo topic, I felt right away that this definitely was something of some significant importance. And then following up with that, I noticed that NASA had also kind of gotten involved with wanting to check the site. So that put my antennas up, so to speak, and I began really digging into trying to find out exactly what this thing is and how much information that I could possibly collect on it. The only thing is, most of my ability to collect information was based on the OceanX team, so I had to follow them very closely, or as closely as I possibly could. Some people are thinking that it might be an ancient construction, an actual type of a structure or building. And some people are going towards the fact that it might be an actual object that flew or flying UFO. I'm actually going in the direction of the UFO just because after evaluating all of the available data on the topic, the size, which I think is about 60 meters, about which is maybe in 200 feet, I believe it is, and then the shape of it, which really has the shape of an object which has been described over many generations what we would consider to be a UFO, and then also the actual anomaly that has left behind on the floor of the seabed, which looks like a skid pattern or a skid mark to where it eventually stopped in that current location. And then also I'm taking into consideration that the depth of the object, how deep it is in the sea, and the location, and the fact that no other major city structures or construction pieces were found within the vicinity of it. To me, it just seems like it's possibly a crashed UFO. So that's kind of the direction that I'm going in. My theory is going based on it might be actually a UFO or an object that flew. I'm thinking and going back into some of the ancient tablets that I've read, like the Mahabharata and the Bhagavad Gita, when they had a lot of these are Indian epics in the Vedas, where they had a lot of these ancient wars where these gigantic sky cities would actually fight each other. And some of these sky cities would explode, some crash back to the ground. There's been numerous artworks depicting these types of battles in the sky. And I feel that this is possibly a casualty of one of those sky wars that happened that back in deep, deep antiquity. So not that this is a modern UFO that just came here and crashed within the last 100 years. I'm talking about maybe 10, 15, 20 thousand years ago. I'm thinking this might be an actual flying machine or vimana, as the ancients called it, that crashed due to some type of a war. It looked like it might have been taken on some type of a battle and crashed. So that's the theory that I'm kind of going with right now, is the theory that it actually may be a crashed UFO. I'd like to see what's inside. I know that, so some of the work that I do with underground construction on Earth, on the top of the planet, there's ground penetrating radar devices that you can actually glide across the ground. We would use these devices to scan underneath the surface of the layers of Earth to discover what exactly is down there before we begin to dig, and to see what type of rock layers exist, if there's any flowing water in that area deep and underground. And I'm wondering if one of these types of devices can be suited or waterproofed with some type of a pressure chamber maybe put around it that can actually survive the depth and the water to go down there and run over the top of the actual object, the Baltic Sea Anomaly itself, and sides kind of like, almost like doing a scan of it one row at a time, back and forth. And it may take several divers to get it done because it's a very big object, but to see if they can actually get an image of what may be underneath or inside of the actual object. That would be fantastic if we could find a way. Again, everything is predicated on money and finances. So if I wasn't working on the Anunnaki movie, I would finance this one myself, because this is at the top of my list of interesting things on this planet. I'd like to find a way to do that. That would be fantastic. So that's my take on it. I think it's a UFO.
Even if it's natural, it might be that some ancient people has been there. We don't know.
Hello, I'm Jan-Peter de Jong. I am. I've been working on a theory that might be able to explain what the anomaly is. I've been working in Peru several years with Jesus Camara. He and his father came up with a very interesting theory that says that many ancient structures over the world are from a time period much older than what we think normally. And they call this the Hanan-Pacha period, and also the style of building is called this way. And this building style is are rocks, the living rock, and in the rock they did a lot of things, and it's very difficult to repeat it nowadays because it seems to have been done with the technology we don't have anymore. So we can see this typical cuts in the rock as if it was cheese, as if this rock
was once soft on the moment of construction. And we can see this in all the Inca ruins in many places over the world. We compare it, for example, with the underground chamber of the Great Pyramid and with the hypogeum in Malta. We compare it with Yonaguni, the underwater ruins near Japan. So we think that there is a possibility that the anomaly in the Baltic Sea is something similar, like Yonaguni or all the Ganapachya structures that we can see in Cusco or at other ancient places over the world. In short, this is our theory, and this is what we think the anomaly could be.
Was this the scoop, the fantastic pictures of the lifetime, or was it just a rock?
Hi, my name is Jarmo Kortanimi. I'm by training I'm a planetary geomorphologist. And that means I interpret remote sensing images and geophysical data and figure out from those what the geology underneath is. And my specialities are glacial landforms and volcanoes and asteroid impacts. And I've studied these things in Finland, Iceland, Germany, US, and most importantly on the moon and on Mars. So. About this Baltic anomaly thing, there's a lot to cover. The site is intriguing. It's very interesting to see what it takes to dive to such places and what it looks like up close. But I have to say, the site is absolutely no anomaly whatsoever. On the contrary, you need to look at the context to see what it actually is. The anomaly, so-called anomaly, looks just like one of the hundreds or thousands of drumlin-like features all around the seabed and on dry land in Finland and Sweden. And drumlins are formed by glacial activity when the ice scrapes the bedrock and boulders below. And what some people call the runway is a typical lee side of a drumlin. And what some people call a UFO is by definition not a UFO, since it's not flying. And it may be the exposed core boulder of the drumlin and fractures that you can see on the site, and nicely polished rock surfaces are quite common in on rocks in the region. And I think the diver said something like the rock is on top of the sediments, but I don't think they actually dug underneath, so it's a bit far-fetched to say such a thing. And when you're studying something like this, you shouldn't just scrape the surface, you should go inside. So I just suggest that somebody goes there during the winter on ice and takes a drill and drills it through the water and through the rock, and I bet that they will find rocks and sediments. And the volcanic idea is far-fetched. Subglacial eruptions don't form things like that. Just go to Iceland and see what they are. And the crust is really thick here. There's maybe 200 kilometers of solid rock underneath our feet, and to get volcanism working through this Scandinavian shield, it's, I don't know what it would require, but there's not, I can't think of anything. And volcanism isn't localized like that almost ever. Magma doesn't just pop up. It forms fractures and dikes and other stuff that are, you can see them in geophysical data. And even if it doesn't come up to the surface. And there should be some volcanic boulders that have been moved by the glacier during the ice age, but there's no evidence of that. So there's no volcanic activity in the region. And somebody said it's a meteorite. Absolutely not. If it would be a 60-meter wide meteorite, it would form a 1 to 2 kilometer wide impact crater, which we don't see, and the meteorite would be broken up. And that's not an opinion, that's physics. And lastly, there's absolutely nothing really special about magnetic anomalies or gravity anomalies. Those are everywhere, and they are caused by the bedrock. And just look at the local gravity and magnetic magnetic maps of the Baltic Sea. So that's my opinion. I'd say that it's an educated guess and very near to the absolute truth.
Perhaps this is something that is constructed, but it's still a but, you know, we don't really know.
My name's Ollie. I'm from England, near Leeds, and my thoughts on the Baltic Sea, Thomas. I believe that there's something down there that is of an extraterrestrial origin. What it is, I don't know. It's possibly, a lot of people think it may be a UFO that's crashed in the sea. I don't know if it is. I'm thinking more along the lines of some sort of intelligent dome that could have had intelligent life in there, maybe an underwater base, a small base, because I mean, these extraterrestrials, we don't actually know how big they were in scale to us, because you see images of extraterrestrials on walls, and a lot of them seem smaller than human beings. So this object, who's to know how far this object actually goes down as well? To me, I find that extremely interesting. What I would like to see is, when they get down there, is them to chip away some of the barnacles and things that are on there, so I can actually see what material is underneath. That would be interesting to know, if it's not just a rock formation that's actually been carved out, that it has some sort of, I think it would have some sort of metallic substance to it.
It could be anything. It sure looked strange on the sonar pictures.
Hi, I'm Angela Davis, and here to talk about the Baltic Sea anomaly. My thoughts on it are regarding, you know, the structure from the sonar scans originally reminded me of High Place in Jordan, in Petra, and I think, you know, to me, the shape reminds me a lot of some ancient structures, you know, from the steps of some ancient ruins in Egypt, you know, leading up, you know, to some of the courtyards around the pyramids, and also it also reminds me, you know, the straight lines in the sonar scan of the Malta cart ruts. I don't think those straight lines are natural. I think those look man-made to me. And so anyway, I've been asked to speak, you know, about that. So that's kind of my thoughts on it, you know, that it looks like Petra, High Place in Jordan originally. That was my thoughts. And of course, there's also some mounds that they say are natural in Aruba that you may see the pictures of, that kind of remind me of that. And, you know, these natural formations also around the Baltic Sea, there are some islands around that region that have kind of these formations where the rocks naturally heave themselves from the rock face into the surrounding water. And even those structures don't quite look natural if you look at them. And so, you know, it could be, you know, a man-made structure, an ancient structure. And, you know, also we're familiar with, you know, that the U.S. and, you know, they do a lot of military testing in the Baltic Sea. They have these yearly military where the U.S. goes over there and all these naval ships get together and they, you know, they do all these exercises in the Baltic Sea. And, you know, I'm sure that has, they have dropped whatever bombs go down in the water, you know, could have exploded down there and created damage on the seafloor that would have melted or, you know, created some sort of, you know, a dome effect if they were just dropping, you know, the bombs down into the water. They hit the ocean floor and explode. And so these ocean mines that, you know, could have been causing this damage and heating up the surface, you know, when they explode. But, you know, we can't monitor that to know what they've done. So it could be military in nature. So those are my thoughts on what it could be. And again, the original sonar scan from Ocean X to me reminds me of Petra, High Place, Jordan, that shape, that structure with the steps and the circle. That's my original thought.
My thoughts about the anomaly has been all the time that it is most probably something natural.
My name is Grant Pearson. I'm a geologist in Australia, currently in Sydney, Australia. My belief is that the anomaly is a geological feature in the main, with the current information that we have. It is obvious from the sonar scans that we're looking at bedding and layering of rock on the seabed that's been weathered. In the dim distant past, there was quite heavy weathering and quite fast flowing waters through the Baltic. At one point, it was not inundated. And there is evidence of villages and the like within the Baltic. So there's obviously high likelihood of the scouring and various things from high energy waters. The object itself, I believe to be a harder layer than the surrounding material, hence why it appears to be standing up above everything else on almost a pinnacle. Everything below it has been weathered away, so it appears to be standing up above as if it's been placed or landed on top of things. The various other things that many people grab a hold to, like 90 degree angles and the holes that are in the top, are quite easily explained in a geological context. The holes on top, potholes, can form basically when flowing water flows across the surface. If there's a stone, it can be spun and slowly but surely cause a pothole to develop. And there's many instances of that looking identical to what we see on the anomaly. The 90 degree surfaces, which many people claim to not exist in nature, are quite common in nature, particularly in basalts and the like. And basaltic columns are generally a six-sided structure with basically, when they crack off
at the top, you can quite often get a 90 degree angle from the top face down the side. So I would never discount that it's definitely a geological feature. One of the other things that people mention is the split mountain, as it's called, and claim that the object appears to have come through, left a skid mark, which to me is just weathered faces of bedding planes, and has crashed through this mountain. Now, if you look at the sonar scans, it's apparent that the split mountain is two sides of one geological layer, as it were, and it's just weathered down the middle. Again, I wouldn't 100% discount that the object itself is something that is not native to the location. It may have fallen off a barge, or may have been placed there or constructed in the dim dark reaches of time when there was no water there. But all the evidence we have so far, and all the evidence provided with the geochemical results and the sonar scans and the video and still images, all indicate that it is, unfortunately for many people, it indicates it is a geological feature and nothing more. It is a very interesting geological feature. It has many peculiarities that possibly don't occur together anywhere else. But again, I believe that it is wholly and solely a geological feature.
I must also say, when we were out there, as you know, it was a lot of strange things happening around the boat.
Hello, my name is Stan Constantin. I have 37 years old. I'm from Romania. My beliefs regarding the anomaly, after I've seen what Dennis Åsberg and Peter Lindberg discovered in 2012, I was very sure that she is an intergalactic ship. Probably fell down from sky 100,000 years ago or more, but for sure it's an intergalactic ship. My guess it's came in from Lyra constellation. That is all I am certain, and I know for sure that his inhabitants are in a state of deep sleep, not cryogenic sleep, like we've seen in more science fiction movies. No, and they are aware of what is happening every time around the ship, because on the first movie from Dennis Åsberg, after Stefan Hogeborn dive up from the anomaly, they've seen on radar two small dots climbing very fast from 90 meters depth to surface in 2 or 3 seconds or more, and they were very scared about that. So his discoveries speaks for himself, and my belief is it's an intergalactic ship, probably a warship. That is all I know, and I'm very sure about that.
This is actually some result from an old volcanic eruption.
Hi, my name is Laura Funke. Like many others, I was intrigued and began following the OceanX team in 2011 when I read about their discovery of this formation in the Baltic Sea. I'm a member of their discussion group, and during the last 5 years, I've participated in many discussions, speculating with other group members about various theories. For the most part, I've always felt that the formation was most likely natural. At one time, I thought there was a possibility of it being altered by ancient man. However, I've changed my view on this since I've learned that the Baltic Sea hasn't been dry for a very, very long time, certainly way before humans were around. Based on the seabed maps of the Baltic, the formations in the area do look like drumlins. I've read and researched a lot of science articles relating to geology in the Baltic, as well as articles about volcanic and seismic activity. One of my first theories was that the formation was a large ancient asphalt dome, taking into account the shape of the formation and the black petrified looking material. Now, after seeing the latest still shots taken from the recently recovered ROV video footage, I see what appears to be possibly hardened flowed magma. That, along with information about ferromanganese concretions, the reported electronic problems and the compass deviations, as well as the large magnetic anomaly located north of Aylin Islands, all of which can be attributed to volcanic or seismic activity, by the way, lead me to speculate that the formation could be the remains of some old volcanic activity in that area. Everything that is known to date about this area confirms that there hasn't been any volcanic activity in the Baltic for millions of years. But what if the formation is the result of an ancient or recent erupted lava tube? If the formation is of this nature, it certainly would cause a stir in the scientific community. Would surrounding countries and scientists want to ignore a discovery like that? It would be detrimental to expose a discovery such as that, what with all the nuclear facilities surrounding the Baltic. But what do I know? Then again, it could be just a large, roundish glacial erratic. I am certainly not a scientist. I am only someone interested enough to continue following this and speculating, just like all the rest of us. I'll continue following the OceanX team and wish them success in all of their projects. Thank you.
That we have this track on the bottom. This looks like something have, in my eyes, crashed.
Hello, my name is John Johnstone, and I live in Philadelphia. And I also work as a physicist in a medical situation, which means I deal with radioactive materials, X-ray producing machines, other radiation producing machines, and I also teach radiation physics at one of the local universities. As I've seen different pictures of the anomaly, different scans, different ideas, and plus my knowledge of physics, I've come to a lot of conclusions, of course, with being a physicist. You kind of perceive things one way and expect things to happen another way as a result. But you can also go backwards, because just like I see the anomaly as something that was created by metals that came from rocks, I also see it as something that's been degraded and going back to the rock. So I guess I'll get back to what I think it is and what happened with it way back when. First of all, I think it's been there since the ocean was created, since before the ocean was created. And the reason I say this is because I've looked at that color side scan, and what I see is an object hitting a hill and decelerating as a result and making a drag pattern and coming to rest. If there had been water in there, there wouldn't have been quite an impact on that hill and such a drag pattern. Water really slows things down. And I'll get into another reason why I believe there was not water at the time. I think the object is is made by beings. I think it was made, like I said, many, many years ago, before there were humans on Earth even. And I think it landed there by accident. I don't think they intended on crashing into a hill, and I don't think they survived the crash. Now, other reasons I believe this is artificial and why it landed like it did and so on, I look at, say it was a meteorite. If it was a meteorite that was coming into Earth, it would have disintegrated. It would have not stayed as a disc-shaped object with walls and floors and corridors. It would be broken up into little bits and incinerated before it even got to Earth, for the most part. There might be a couple little pieces of it left, but this is a very solid object that was made of some sort of alloy. However, when it entered the Earth's atmosphere at an incredible speed, it became very hot. And so hot that when it came into the landing, when it came to rest, it was still very, very hot. And it actually caused a lava effect around the periphery of the object. So what you're going to see is you're going to see the actual, what's ever on the ground around the object, turn into kind of like a molten lava. And also, when the object hit that hill, it caused an explosion of debris from that hill that rose in the air very high. And when the object came to rest, some of those rocks from that hill landed on top of the object, and they became incinerated as well. So after all this time, after that whole incineration and the object sitting there and the ocean pouring on top of it, what you have is an alloy that's very much degraded, not only from heat, but also just from over time and sitting in the ocean. So what happens is when you analyze these rocks, you kind of have a fusion of what was already there and the alloy that the ship was made of. And the edges of it are actually more damaged than the central part. That's why you're able to get into the corridors. That's why the meringue or whatever that round object is on top. The reason it doesn't look like a metallic structure anymore is because it's been burnt to hell. So I think if they chisel away another foot of rock, they're going to find something more substantial as a significant alloy. However, the thing could have been so hot that now it is in fact a rock. It went from a rock to a spaceship and back to a rock just because it heated up to such an incredibly high temperature. And like I said, nothing could have survived that. If they were able to cable it and drag it ashore or put balloons on it, they might be able to get inside of it. If they found something, would they be able to extract DNA? Would they find any remains or any skulls? Possibly, it could be very much sealed off. And the radiation factor, there could be radiation around, not only because some spaceship might have a power plant with a uranium source or something, but generally when things are heated to a very high temperature, they tend to change their composition and even become slightly radioactive. Just like when you metabolize potassium in your body, you actually produce radiation in your body. So stay away from too much potassium. anyway, the sad thing is, not only is that object hard to reach, I don't think humans are ready for any type of disclosure or the fact that, you know, a group of aliens crashed here before there were even humans here. Nobody wants to believe that, or the general population doesn't really believe that sort of thing. And even as much as I've seen UFOs, and they've been reported to the news, it's all, to the average person, very, very skeptical. So I totally believe in these other beings. I believe the universe is endless. They're not just rocks out there and we're the only unique planet. I think they visit us a lot, but there's always the germ factor. There's always the fact that they could give us a virus and knock us out, or they can contract something from us. Viruses are very, very microscopic and very complex. And that's probably why we've kept our distance for so long. Another thing I wanted to mention about the drag pattern and its current state, if you look at the mountain that was hit by the object, you can see it's filled in some. Of course, after you hit an object, initially the outside of it explodes, but then some of it implodes and it falls into the cracks. There's also a lot of silt in the ocean, so the drag pattern is going to fill with silt and anything else that's loose. So that's why it may seem more raised in that area, even though it's concave, I should say. It's actually convex on top because there's softer objects filling in that space. So I'm fully convinced it is an artificial object. I'm fully convinced it was there before the ocean. And I'm fully convinced it was molten hot when it came to rest. So hopefully I have some people who agree with me. I don't know that we're ever going to get down there and get that thing out of there or be able to look inside of it, because it is just like a piece of lava from Hawaii now.
Hi, I'm Billy Carson. I'm co-founder of UFA, United Family of Anomaly Hunters. Also the founder of Forbidden Knowledge on Facebook and Instagram.
My name is Grant Pearson. I'm a geologist in Australia and currently in Sydney, Australia.
Hello, my name is John Johnstone and I live in Philadelphia. And I also work as a physicist.
Hi, my name is Jarmo Kortanimi. I'm a, by training, I'm a planetary geomorphologist.
Hi, I'm Angela Davis, and here to talk about the Baltic Sea Anomaly.
Hello, I'm Jong. I've been working on a theory that might be able to explain what the anomaly is.
Hello, my name is Stan Constantin.
My name's Ollie. I'm from England.
Hi, my name is Laura Funke.